My name is Rhonda Sciortino, and I was the CEO of a company that I started when I was 27 years old, Human Services Insurance, and the company I started, I think in 1995, Child Welfare Insurance Services. I've also founded a nonprofit organization, Successful Survivors Foundation. In the course of the years that I have been in business, there are so many times that I've thought, oh man, if I just had this, fill in the blank. I want to share those five things with you today because we can do these things. So the first one, women supporting women, business support groups. So think Vistage or Townsend Leadership or something like that, but it's for women, it's by women, because let me tell you the reality. We can go to Chamber of Commerce meetings or other kinds of business support meetings, but we're really not going to be fully transparent in front of, you know, all the men who are there about what our real concerns are. The real concerns of trying to juggle a family and a business. You know, who's going to pick up the kid from school when the kid's running a fever and somebody's got to pick up that child? What about getting kids to and from practice and all the extracurricular activities? What about caring for aging parents? Trying to keep your marriage together? Yeah, there are just so many things that women have to balance in addition to running their businesses. If women all in business all got together and supported one another, in these things, it would make a world of difference. I mean, just to be able to talk to somebody who's been there and been through it and survived it, somehow figured it out, would be very, very important. Number two, community networks of women in business. Now, what I mean by that are women in the community, in the general community, coming together to be that village for women who are running their businesses. Listen, there are women who are not in the workplace for various reasons. Maybe it's a woman with disabilities. Maybe it's a woman who's retired. A woman who's home raising her own kids. These women can provide all the support services for women who have launched out and started their own business. I used to say all the time, when I had a school-age daughter and my business, and I was working, oh my goodness, you know, 60 to 80 hours a week. It was crazy. And I would say all the time, you know what I need? I really need a wife. And what I meant was, I need somebody to be at the house waiting for the repair guy to come, for the repair person to come, for the window that they give you of 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. I needed somebody to take and pick up my dry cleaning. I needed somebody to arrange for groceries, to help me with birthday cards and gifting and entertaining. There were so many things that I could have used help with. And there are so many women out there who are fabulous at those things. They would like to earn money, you know, doing those kinds of things. So women supporting women in the community, I think, would be incredibly valuable. Number three, women-led, mission-driven venture capital groups. How about that, right? If women who have the time and treasure to invest would invest in someone who has a solid business plan, good work ethic, you know, the energy and the vitality to really make a go of it, the determination and perseverance that it takes to really be successful in business. If women would invest in that woman, and I don't mean just money, to stay connected and stay involved and to watch her and cheer her on and support her and give advice, I think it would be incredibly powerful. Think about it. Women who have the money to invest can put it in the stock market, maybe in a mutual fund, and have absolutely no emotional connection to that whatsoever. Well, if you, and I'm not saying we put all of our money into some new startup, but hey, you know, maybe some of it could come together, pool it together with other women in the same kind of financial situation, and find the right person to invest in, to embrace, to lift up, and to celebrate. I think that would be incredibly rewarding. Number four, I used to go and listen to speakers and read books, success books, business books. Almost all of the speakers were men. And I think every single one of the books I read back then had been written by men. They were very helpful, don't get me wrong, but I think it would be incredibly powerful to be able to hear women who have been in the C-suite or are in the C-suite who started and built their own businesses. I want to hear them talk. How about a female in business, women in business speaker series? Maybe it's a once a month meeting. Maybe it's something that's on the internet, but to be able to hear a woman who's been there and done that, for her to share what she went through, the great times, the hard times, the almost didn't make it times, would be incredibly helpful, I think, and supportive to women who are, you know, in the hard middle of trying to get a business off the ground or trying to keep a business going during a pandemic. Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Number five, the last one that I have for today would be, you know, I think that we would all, women in particular, but a lot of people, would support women-owned businesses if we knew which businesses were women-owned. Not everybody says that. I know when I started my company, I didn't say that I was the owner. As a matter of fact, the majority of my prospective clients were what I called OWM. Not politically correct. It stood for old white men. And I was this young girl, you know, obviously not anymore, but that was many years ago when I started out. But here I was young. My prospective clients were older men. I was competing usually against men, many of them older. And so I was at a distinct disadvantage. So I actually printed up business cards when I started my company that said vice president. And anytime somebody would ask for some kind of a special arrangement, a special payment plan or something like that, I would say, oh, I would love to do that for you. Let me put you on hold and ask my boss. And I would put the phone on hold and, you know, wait a little tick. And then I'd come back on and say, he said okay. And so after a couple of years, when I had some really good market penetration, I reprinted my business cards and I promoted myself to president of my company. Nobody knew in those first years that I was one person on the floor of my condo, making all the calls and doing all the work. And I was on the floor because I'd sold all my furniture in order to start my business. Well, nowadays it's a totally different, I think, environment. And so if we had a hashtag or we had some kind of a logo or something that a woman could put prominently on her website, on her social media, on her business card, that showed that it was a woman-owned business. I know, for one, as I'm looking and I'm choosing between one product and the next, I would probably lean toward supporting my sister in business. And so that's my fifth recommendation. Wouldn't it be so fun if over the next few years we saw all of these things become a reality? I hope there's some woman out there listening right now who says, hey, you know what? I could do that. I could start that. Do it. Do it. Start it in your community. I think that women have a greater tendency to start mission-driven companies to solve a problem in the world, to do good in the world. And we can do well while doing good. So take these ideas, run with them, and I want to hear from you. You can reach me. You can contact me on my website, Rhonda, R-H-O-N-D-A.org.